Thank you. and bless his name. Surrender all of ourselves to you. Have your way in this place. Let anything that is unlike you, let it be removed. We're here for one purpose, and that's to give you glory and give you honor, Lord God, for blessing us all through the week. Lord God, thank you for keeping us, Lord, safe, Lord God. Thank you for when I didn't think I was going to make it, Lord God. You picked me up and you turned me around. You dust me off, Lord God, and you said, go on, my child. You'll be all right. Hallelujah. I know that with every step I take it with you. You said that you'll never leave me nor forsake me, Lord God. So we thank you, Lord God. We lift you up, Jesus, because you're worthy in this praise. And as we continue to lift our hands, we surrender all to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now come on and put those blessed hands together. Hey, come on, come on.
You move mountains. You cause walls to fall with your power. Perform miracles. There is nothing. You move mountains, you move mountains.
making a way.
Always making a way.
Come on, say always.
Always making a way.
Whatever you need, God has it.
He's always making a way.
You cause walls to fall.
With your power.
Perform miracles.
There is nothing.
That's impossible.
And we're standing here only because you made a way. Anybody grateful that the Lord makes a way? Out of no way. Come on, give God a great praise in this room today. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I want you to be a witness to your neighbor of the goodness of the Lord. Come on, share with your neighbor how good the Lord has been to you. Hallelujah. In my tests and trials, he always makes a way. And I believe this morning, if he did it before, I believe he'll do it again. Look at the neighbor and say, I believe for you. He'll do it again. Hey, I seen you move.
You move the mountain.
And I believe.
I see you do it.
You made a way.
Gonna work in your favor. No, no, no. no, no, no. You all don't sound like you know that he's going to work in your favor. You don't know what the enemy might have come up against you. So you got to be ready at all times. Have your shield up at all times. So if you know that he's going to work in your favor, come on and bless his name right now. Every time I turn around, he's going to work in my favor. So I'm going to keep my shield up. Because the enemy might try me. But I got Jesus on my side.
Testimony today. Come on, God's gonna work in your favor. Come on, we all know that if you're a living witness of God's working power in your life, why don't you take your neighbor by the hand today? Well, he's a good God on this 47th day of a brand new year. Amen. Come on, hallelujah. A working in our favor kind of God. Amen. Daddy, we thank you today that we are living witnesses, that you are a working in our favor kind of God. Daddy, time really won't allow for us to express it today, but we just want to say thank you. Thank you, Father, for every mountain. Thank you, Daddy, for every valley and for all of the places in between. We're gathered into this worship experience today for no other reason but to worship you. Some of us rushed here, some of us have been here for a while, some of us are still on our way, but wherever we find ourselves, it's in our heart, Father, today to worship you. There is nobody like you. Nobody, Daddy, can do what you've done. Nobody can turn situations around the way that you have done it. Nobody, God, can carry our tears the way that you can. Nobody can give us the miracles the way that you do. Nobody. Some writer said, God, I've searched and I've searched and I've looked and I've looked. I found nobody, Daddy, that was like you. So today, collectively, God, we just want to say you are worthy. And we continue to surrender this worship experience unto you. God, touch every aspect of the experience. Let your Holy Spirit continue to fill this place. For every song that we'll sing, the scriptures that we're going to read, Lord God, for the candles that are going to come and the word that's going to come forth, God, we ask for an anointing today, God, that would fall afresh on every heart and every mind and every soul, even those that are online, that they would experience, God, the fullness of your presence. Manifest yourself, God, in the name of Jesus. We need a word from you on today. So, God, in Jesus' name, let it be so. Touch the preachers of the hour, and God, add to the body of Christ today. Save somebody today. Heal somebody today. Deliver somebody today. Let it be so, God, in the name of Jesus. Father, we don't want a regular worship experience, so we're going to surrender everything we have unto you, and we're going to focus our minds and our hearts on worshiping you. We're going to give you everything we have today. We're not going to let any rocks cry out for us today. We thank you in advance for what you are going to do. But if you agree with this prayer, come on, put your hands together. Come on, give God some praise today. As a strong. Praise the Lord. The word of the Lord this morning comes out of the book of Matthew, the 5th chapter, and I'll be reading verses 38 through 48 in your hearing. Hear these words now. You have heard that it was said, eye for an eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt and hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. From all that dwells. Said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the
this morning as we are led further in worship by this mighty aggregation of singing.
King Jesus, I'm listening when you pray. King Jesus, I'm listening when you pray. He's waiting to hear you. Comfort. King Jesus is listening when you pray. King Jesus is listening when you pray. He's waiting to hear you, comfort and cheer you. King Jesus is listening when you pray. If I hold my peace, my Jesus will be coming for me one day. King Jesus is listening when you pray. He's got power in his hand and he's taking me away. King Jesus is listening when you pray. Oh, King Jesus is listening. Oh, listening when you pray. He's got power in his hand and he's taking me away. King Jesus is listening when you pray. Whoa, King Jesus is listening. Whoa, listening when you pray. He's got power in his hand and he's taking me away. King Jesus is listening. 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 King Jesus is listening.
Oh, hallelujah. Give this chorale a hand clap of praise. Amen. Amen. Singing the literally singing the songs of Zion. We thank and praise God for the gifts. Amen. And for the vocal arrangement. Amen. Thank and praise God for the band. And just thank and praise God for being in the house of the Lord one more time. God has blessed us and gifted us with another day. For that, we ought to be grateful and glad. Anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? The Bible says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And so for that, we're grateful and we're glad. Again, we greet those who are joining us online. We encourage you and welcome you to worship along with us. We are kingdom, and we're continuing to move in that direction in the month of February and all year long and all lifelong. Amen. As God has given us life, we are moving to be kingdom focused in our lives, in our ministries, and however God chooses to move, we are focused on the kingdom. Again, we are just encouraging everyone to not only recognize Black History Month, celebrate, remember, educate all others. Amen. About Black History Month, it's not just a month for us. Amen. But while it is on the calendar, we certainly can highlight those pioneers, those milestones in the life of our history. Amen. And just this past Friday, I mentioned last week, we celebrate the history of the African Methodist Episcopal Church Founders Day. Amen. Our founder, Richard Allen, was born on February 14th in the year 1760. All of the AME ministers and pastors, they met down in, I believe it was Raleigh, North Carolina, this past weekend for Founders Day meeting. Our very own pastor preached, amen, the sermon there. And so we're grateful for the gifts in the body of Christ in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Know your history, educate, amen, and pass it on to the next generation so that they can know that we are a blessed people, amen, and that down through the years, God has been faithful towards us, and it does not yet appear what God shall do in the life of this church and the life of his people. Can you say amen? Amen. And certainly we want you to be aware of the opportunities to be blessed by the events and ministries here at Kingdom Fellowship. Continue to take a look at your gather guide throughout the month. There are many opportunities for you to be a part of ministry activities. Our outreach, our goal ministry certainly has opportunities where you can be a part of the outreach efforts that we have. And then Pastor will highlight some of the upcoming things that we have in the life of this church. This is our Kingdom Love, Kingdom Matters month. And so we have been in our series of teaching and preaching all month long about what it means, love, according to the Bible's standard and definition of love. And so we are continuing to emphasize love this month. Amen. At this time, we want to recognize any first-time guest persons who are not members of Kingdom Fellowship, but perhaps you pressed your way here this morning. We want to take time to recognize you. Any first-time guests, returning guests, we invite you to stand as you are able. Any first-time guests, God bless you. I see you in the back. Amen. Do we have others? I see you as well. Amen. Our greeters are making their way towards you. They're going to greet you with a smile. They're also going to place in your hand a welcome packet, a gather guide rather, and we ask that you would read the contents inside and fill out the information inside so that we can stay in touch with you. On behalf of the best senior pastor on this side of glory, the Reverend Matthew L. Watley, all of the officers and members here of Kingdom Fellowship, we love you with the joy of Jesus Christ. We ask that when you leave that you will come back again and worship with us and invite someone else to do the same. Now when all of the good members of Kingdom Fellowship stand with an all-star smile on your face, greet our guests, greet one another, and let them know that I'm glad to see you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's fellowship, everybody. If you love Jesus and you love his church, here we go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather,
we're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord.
We're so glad.
So glad you chose to join us. Let's grow in the word together. Give our hearts to Jesus. We can make a difference. Go share the love of
Jesus with the world. Everybody say, gather, grow.
Gather, grow, give, grow.
kingdom focus.
We're kingdom focus. We gather to worship the Lord.
Yeah.
So glad you chose to join us. Let's grow in the word together.
Oh, we give our hearts
to Jesus.
We can make the difference.
Go share the love of Jesus.
Oh. Come on, clap your hands this time. Gather. To Jesus, we can make the difference.
Go share the love of Jesus with the world.
We'll share the gospel. Oh,
we'll share with the world.
Amen. Kingdom. Amen. God bless you. You may take your seats in the presence of the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. We're rejoicing. Amen. Glad to be in the service one more time. Glad to be celebrating Kingdom Love Matters 2020. Glad to be closing out the marriage retreat. Amen. We want to celebrate. Amen. Amen. Love, love, love matters. Amen. And we're excited. Amen. And I was not able to be there because I had to be at the midwinter meeting of the Second Episcopal District down in Greensboro, North Carolina. I had to preach down there, but I understand that the couples had a good time. In fact, one couple told me, they said, Rev, you know, we sure did miss you and Sister Shauna, especially at the party. Next year, y'all make sure you're there, but don't stay the whole time, Rev. Y'all should come and say hey, and then y'all should go, because we had a good time. I didn't ask any questions. I'm old enough to not ask any questions that need answering. And so we're grateful to God for our marriage ministry and all those that shared in that experience. And we're believing that there was a deposit investment made into these marriages that will bring a return, some 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. We also want to lift up the fact that Kingdom Love Matters month continues. Next weekend is singles time. Amen. Yeah. All right, singles, let me hear you. Amen. Matter of fact, all the singles, raise your hand. Amen. Like last week, raise your hand and look around. Look around. Make a friend. Look around. Make a friend. Little eye contact never hurt anybody. That's actually not true. But we're going to be next weekend doing the Kingdom, the K-Fame takeover of Pike and Rose for the singles. It's about to be off the Ever-Loving Chain. We're going to kick it off with a panel. Then we're going to have some fun. Amen. There's going to be a jazz / neo soul / R&B brunch. Amen. At the Canopy, there's going to be a day party with hand dancing and line dancing. There's going to be a bowling party. And then we're going to get everybody back together for the dating game live. And so we want to encourage you. Amen. We're already almost filled up. And so I want to encourage you to get your spot today. And brothers, I want to encourage you, amen, all right, hey, easy tiger, easy, easy tiger, amen. All right, so anyhow, it's a rowdy crowd up in here. Amen. Security. That's DC for security. Anyhow, we want to encourage you to sign up, Damo. And so I'm encouraging us to be in the house. We're going to have an awesome time in the Lord, and look to see your face in a place as we close out with Reverend Danielle Brown next Sunday. She's coming down from Perth Amboy, New Jersey. She's going to bless us real good. And we're excited about it. Amen. Also excited because we have the tallies. Listen to this, the tallies from our Financial Peace University. Even though we have over 400 and something persons participating, only 300 persons so far have filled out their debt and their cash totals. Listen to this, for the 300 persons that completed the forms, that represents a total debt, not counting mortgages. Yeah, somebody said, oh Lord, already, and you're a prophetess, amen. $28 million. 300 persons have red debt, not counting mortgages, of $28 million, total savings of $7.5 million. And so we are excited that this is the starting point. We're going to be doing the before and after pictures. Amen. This is what we look like before, and this is what it's going to look like after we've gotten our financial house in order. We want to celebrate all those who are journeying with us through this financial fast for 2020. I've shared with you, and there have been several other churches that just launched their financial fast this week. When we first started this church, we said one of the things we wanted to do was not just be a blessing here, but we wanted to be a blessing to the body of Christ. And so we shared all of our information, and now other churches are joining us with the Foresight 2020 financial fast. And so we're going to be blessed, and others are going to be blessed, and we'll all be blessed. Amen. We want to be a blessing to several faith family members who've lost loved ones recently as a part of our congregation. Be in prayer for Sister Natalie Pasco, whose mother made her transition, as well as Sister Wanda Smith, who's with us today, whose brother also transitioned. We shared that the other night. Brother Ron Davis lost his mother, as well as Brother Darius Davis has lost his father. And so we're asking that you would be in prayer. As you all know, since 2020 has started, we've been in a season of loss as we've never experienced before in the life of this congregation. We're praying that God will continue to comfort, to continue to strengthen, and that we as a church family would help in this process of grief and the celebration of life for each of these families. And so for those of you who have personal connections, we're asking that you would certainly be in prayer. Don't have to say a whole lot often. It's just the ministry of presence that serves as the largest blessing to our brothers and sisters. Let the church say amen. 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 It's time to receive our tithes and offering for this service. We're grateful, God, that we have it to give. We're a blessed church because we're a Bible church. The Bible teaches that tithing is the way of the kingdom. We always extend the invitation every Sunday at every one of our services to see if there's anybody in the house who wants to join us in the tithing ministry. If you're here and you're one of our new tithers, or if you've already been tithing here but you've never been acknowledged as a tither, it's also important you stand because when you stand, you also encourage others to know that tithing is real, because obviously it's working in your life. I want to see if there's anybody in the sanctuary this morning that is new or has never been acknowledged as one of our tithers. If so, I'm going to ask that you would stand so we can thank God for you during this worship experience. Any first time tithers, a person never been acknowledged before as one of our tithers, don't see anybody standing. We want to take this moment to welcome all those who are sharing this worship experience with us online. If you are worshiping with us online, you already know that worship is never, ever complete without sacrifice, without sowing, without giving. And so please, my brothers and sisters, take advantage of one of the electronic means of giving displayed on the screen. For those of us in the sanctuary, we have a fifth means, and that is through the envelope. Whatever means by which you choose to give, my prayer is only that you will give God what is right, not just what's left over. Special shout out one more time to all of our kingdom builders, participants, those who are giving above. Somebody shout above. Amen. We're not just switching envelopes, amen, but we're adding too, because we know that God is going to acknowledge and reward and honor our sacrifice, and that we're going to be able to move into our new church and to do a greater work for the cause of Christ and for the kingdom of God. I'm excited about it. How about you? Amen. And so thank you for your support, as a couple of brothers used to say back in the 80s. Let me just do this now so I can get out the way. I'm going to do it right now. I want to present our preachers for today. Amen. Pastor Warren Campbell and Sister Erica Campbell are in the house, and we're excited to have them come and share. Come on, let's make them, give them some East Coast love. Let's get over the East Coast, West Coast thing. Let's give them some East Coast love. Amen. We're excited to have them in the house, and we certainly are appreciative of their ministry, not simply through music, but by sharing the message of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They have a wonderful ministry there in Los Angeles, one of the leading ministries, in fact, in the Los Angeles area. Some people get a multiplicity and an embarrassment of gifts, and then there are people like me. Amen. They can sing, they can preach, they radio shows, producers, Grammys, all that kind of stuff. And then y'all got me and Shauna. Anyhow, we're excited for them to come and to share. They blessed our marriage retreat on yesterday, and they're going to come today and to sow a seed. And listen, let me just say this. Even if you're not married, you ought to tune in, amen, to what they're saying, so you know what you're looking for. and you know what you're getting into. Anyway, I want to encourage you, amen, to sit with your tent doors open and be ready to receive that which God has to say and to share through them. After the ministry of music has proceeded, we shall receive them in that wise. Come on, y'all, since we're here, let's have church.
February is Kingdom Love Matters Month. We'll be looking at love from several perspectives: successful love, the shackled, shackers, and searchers. On third Sunday, our guest speakers are Warren and Erica Campbell, ministering around the theme, Shackled, for married couples. And closing out Kingdom Love Matters Month is our guest speaker, ministering to the singles, Reverend Dr. Danielle Brown. Kingdom Fellowship singles, get ready for a day to take over Pike and Rose on Saturday, February 29th from 10 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. The day kicks off with a panel discussion on being successfully single. Then you'll have a choice to select from three activities with food: brunch with a live band, a bowling party at Pinstripes, or a day party at Pinstripes with line and hand dancing. Then we'll close out the day with a dating game live, and winners will receive a free group date provided by Kingdom Fellowship. Space is limited, so register today for the singles takeover of Pike and Rose. Registration is available online at kingdom.global/takeover. The cost is only $35 per person and includes your food and activity. Kingdom Fellowship is online around the world. Join with us as we gather, grow, give, and go on social media. Stay connected on Facebook. Subscribe on YouTube. Follow us on Instagram and Twitter. You'll find information about events and outreach, sermons and words of wisdom, photos and videos, and more. Like, subscribe, follow Kingdom Fellowship on social media. It's time to pray until something happens. Reverend Renee Norwood and Kingdom Fellowship's Push Prayer Ministry invite you to another TGIF Prayer Night, Friday, March 6th, with guest preacher, the founding pastor of Love AME Church in Largo, Maryland, Reverend Chris Natasan. Join us for this time of worship, the word, and special prayer for our families, our communities, and our nation. It's Push Prayer Night, March 6th, at Kingdom Fellowship.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Celebrating the love of Jesus, the love between one another. Come on.
When you're lonely and your heart is filled with despair, remember God cares.
Magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together.
Yes.
I don't need you to do it with me, but I just want it. I don't want to be selfish. Oh, magnify the Lord.
With me. Hallelujah.
With me. Come on, can we do it for a second? Just let's exalt his name together. Come on, tell God how good he's been. Tell him what he is to you. Father, we love you. We extol you. Lord, we appreciate you. Hallelujah. Come on, he's been better than that. He's been better than that.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Somebody laid their clothes out last night and didn't wake up this morning. He's been better than that. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Kingdom fellowship. We are so, so happy to be here.
Absolutely.
Giving honor to your illustrious pastor. Come on, you can give him a hand.
Yes.
Pastor Matthew Wiley and First Lady Shana Wiley, who are gifts to the body of Christ. It's something when a church can be known by its fruit all the way across the country.
Yes.
It is the hallmark of great leadership. And so let's give our pastor another hand. Amen, amen. Well, my name is Pastor Warren Campbell.
And I'm Erica Campbell.
And we're the Campbells.
Shout out to Tia, who's in the building, who was responsible for We're the Campbells being on TV
hey,
One.
Tia.
Hey, Tia.
I'd like to give special mention to, you see us up here, we don't do this by ourselves.
Yes.
There's a team of people behind us, and by team, I mean one person. Her name is Sister Misty Anderson. Stand up, Misty. Y'all give Misty some love.
So when y'all see us traveling and all over the place and on the radio show in the morning and in a different city doing a concert at night, usually she's scheduled it all, so if we're not sleeping, she's not sleeping. And we love you for sacrificing on behalf of us. But we don't want to assume that everybody always knows who we are. We've been married for 18 years. Doing music for...
Well, it'll be 19 years this
19
May.
This year, yeah. Happily yeah. married, healthily married. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We got five claps. Ain't nobody happily married with us. This is Love Weekend. We celebrate love. We're supposed to be excited about these things.
We got three children.
Yes.
Yes. Our youngest just turned 8.
Yes.
And then there's my son. He'll be 10 in April. And then this is where we need your special attention and prayer in our lives, because we do have a 15-year-old. Woo! Anybody with teenagers in the house?
Yeah, give us some tips. We need some.
Forget the tips. Give us some prayer. Can we do a teenager fast? We want to get into the Word of God. Is that all right? Come with us to the book of 2 Samuel. Now, it is our custom in our church in California that we stand for the reading of the Word. Can you do that with us?
Amen.
2 Samuel, we'll skip around here, chapter 11, verses 3 through 5. Then we'll skip down to verses 15 through 17. And then I'll skip again and read verse 27. When you got it, say, yes, sir. Y'all ain't ready for me. Y'all ain't ready for me. I said, when you have it, say, yes, sir. Yes, sir. All right.
So David sent and inquired about the woman. And someone said, is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? Then David sent messengers and took her, and she came to him, and he lay with her. For she was cleansed from her impurity, and she returned to her house.
Yeah.
And the woman conceived. So she sent and told David and said, I am with child.
That's right.
Verse 15, and he being David, wrote in the letter saying, set Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle and retreat from him that he may be struck down and die. Jesus. Verse 16. So it was while Joab besieged the city that he assigned Uriah to a place where he knew there were valiant men. Then the men of the city came out and fought with Joab. And some of the people of the servants of David fell, and Uriah the Hittite died also. Down to verse 27 it says, and when her mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Spirit of the living God, we thank you. Father, we thank you for your word. Father, we thank you for the revelation of your word, Father. We ask you now that you hide us behind the cross. Speak with our mouth, think with our minds. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Everybody say, thank God.
Thank God.
Come on, thank God.
Thank God.
Amen, amen. Before you take your seats, can you turn to your neighbor and repeat our subject this morning? Say, neighbor, it's time.
It's time.
For a bag check.
For a bag check.
Okay, that neighbor was asleep. That neighbor's porch light is out. That neighbor's doorbell doesn't work. Go to another neighbor. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
It is indeed.
Time.
For a bag check.
For a bag check.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. So we know this story. We know David, right? We know that what we like to say is he's a man after God's own heart, right? We know that he slew a giant, right? We also know that when Samuel came to his house, looking for who was going to be king, he wasn't the one that was chosen. His own father said, no, couldn't be him. Got to be these strong, strapping young men. It couldn't be David. But it indeed was David. David has all this accumulation into becoming king and all these things that are a part of his bag, his story, things that he holds that we don't realize has an effect on us.
Wow, that's good.
Because it's just our stuff, and we're used to our stuff in our bag. Right? But life has a way of showing you what is in your bag. And so we're going to talk about the baggage that comes and affects us in different ways in our life, as it did David, even though he was a man after God's own heart, even though he's called and chosen and a great musician and a great warrior, David had some stuff. Look at your neighbor and say, David has some stuff.
Look at your other neighbor saying, you do too.
You do too. Yes, yes.
And so we know this story, the backdrop. Everybody's heard this story in Sunday school, but there's another layer to the story. There is a marriage here that we see.
Yes.
Verse 27 clearly states that
Bathsheba became David's wife. But they didn't come into the marriage alone. They came into the marriage with some baggage. David had some baggage, like my wife just said, but Bathsheba had some baggage. She came into the marriage carrying a baggage of loss. She lost her husband. Deceitfully, she lost her husband. And so there's baggage there. And how baggage goes, you know, I'm often traveling. Like when we leave here, I'm going to L.A. My wife is going to
Dallas.
I'm always confused about where she's going.
Don't do that.
She leaves every other day.
I do not.
Pray for me. I'm just sick and sad.
Oh, you so.
But when I get to the airport, as most travelers do, I pack my bag and get there, and I've always noticed that they have a concern about what's in my bag at the airport. They're always concerned. They're asking you questions. Did you pack your bag? Well, did you pack your bag yourself?
Yes.
What's in your bag? Do you have any firearms in your bag? If I did, why would I tell you? And so they're concerned about what's in my bag, because what's in my bag will affect everybody else on the flight. And so they go in my bag, put it through an X-ray machine. Why? Because they're trying to see if what's in my bag is questionable. Mm-hmm. And if I have anything questionable in my bag, then they make me and my bag get out the line.
Yes.
Set me to the side, and they start going through my bag to pull out the unquestionable items so I can go on my flight. And so a lot of us are stagnant in our lives, not just because we're stagnant, because God is now, and the Holy Spirit is now, he's just going through your bag.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And he's pulling out things, yes. And you think I'm just stuck in life. No, God's not done pulling stuff out of your bag. And because you cannot take flight with unquestionable things in your bag. Amen, somebody.
What you carry matters. It matters to you. It matters to others. It matters to your marriage, your ministry, your children. It matters to those who you interact with. Uh-huh. Can I talk a little bit about my bag?
Wait, I'm going to go over here when you talk about your bag. Your stuff is over there. My bag is over here.
Okay, well, listen. All right, well, that's what we're doing then. So I grew up in a big family, 7 sisters, parents who married and divorced each other 3 times. So I have a strange relationship with my confidence, had a strange relationship with my confidence in marriage and the word, I love you, the words, I love you. So when I married my husband and he would say, we were dealing with stuff, young couple getting married, but I love you. And I was like, my dad said that all the time, but he left. So what does I love you mean? I didn't realize that was in my bag. I didn't realize that I had issues with my own past history, having been engaged, my own insecurities, my own issues of moving 15 times, my own issues of being poor and moving from place to place, not having that stability, not feeling like in my mind, I don't need that, I'm fine without it. Look who I've become without it. I don't need it, I'm fine. All of that is in my bag. It's affecting me. It's affecting how I interact with people. It's affecting how I talk to people. It is affecting me because it's in my bag.
Yeah.
I didn't know it was in my bag. And life has a way of showing you just what is in your bag.
Now, my bag was a little different. We all grown up sitting here, let me see. Because suddenly can't say everything. In my bag, I had stuff in my bag that I knew when exposed, she might run.
Yeah.
See, you think you're just living your life and life is just passing by. No, what you're doing is you're accumulating things along the way.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you accumulate stuff, and I didn't realize that I had accumulated an addiction to pornography. Mm-hmm. Being exposed to pornography at 8 years old.
Wow.
I thought I just saw something I wasn't supposed to see. But it was in my bag the whole time. I accumulated a lot of what my wife calls sexual inventory. She'll get into that later.
Yeah.
It was in my bag. There's some women, because of me, before I was even 20 years old, who had abortions. It was in my bag.
Yeah.
So I show up to this relationship. I show up to this marriage in love, for sure, but weighed down by a bunch of baggage. And not only was I weighed down by it, when I get to the marriage, and now it's time to get in here and cohabitate together,
mm-hmm.
and it's time to unpack. There's some stuff in my bag. I know for sure I can't let this stuff out of my bag. So what do? I hide.
Wow. Yeah.
Am I talking to anybody in here?
Mm-hmm.
I hide the stuff.
Yeah.
And I mask the stuff and I try to disguise the things in my bag. And what I don't know is, after a while, that stuff coming out.
For sure.
Whether I want it to or not.
Sometimes you don't realize just how full your bag is.
Oh, come on, come on.
And though you want room for other people and other things, you literally don't have the capacity for anything else. Because I'm so weighed down by what has happened and what I think. And whether you have a big ego about your bag or low self-esteem, you still made it all about you. And if we are believers, it should not just be all about us. What does God want to say? How does God feel? What does God speak to me through me? But when you've taken so much ownership, it's hard to do that. Can I testify? My ego, even though I'm nice and pleasant and all that, my ego was very interesting and very instrumental in the things that happened early in our marriage. Well, you don't want to say nothing, fine. I don't need you. You know who I am. I sing. I'm fine. I'm good. You don't want to come home and talk to me? Fine, I'm good. I have thousands of people who talk to me and listen to my music. Just ignorant. But it's your ego. And you feel like this is how I stand up for myself. But is that God's design? Is that how God stands up in us? Or is it a defense mechanism? Is it a self-preservation type of thing? See, we use the word in ways that suit us.
Wow.
You know what I mean? In ways that allow me, that pacify my bad attitude, that pacify... You know what I mean? We talk about God smiting our enemies when God's only enemy is Satan.
Wow.
Your husband ain't your enemy. Your mama ain't your enemy. The person that did you wrong is not the enemy. They may have been used by the devil, but they are not the devil. And so you put on your spiritual gloves in life and you feel like I'm fighting, I'm defending myself. We love preaching about haters. I don't. People do love preaching about haters. And the haters gonna see, and God is going, I only hate one guy.
Yeah.
How can I be a God of love? How can I be a God of relationship? I created you for relationship, for community. Marriage is supposed to resemble this relationship, this community that allows us to be vulnerable, to bring it all to the altar, whether it's the altar in church or the altar of your marriage, where you're both emptying out and being open and honest enough and fearless enough to address some stuff.
Yeah.
To know that this person that loves me can handle us being honest about this is what it is. So sexual inventory is everything that you've accumulated. So there is an invisible playground that we have that no one sees, that the enemy loves the invisible playground.
Wow.
It's all up here. What you remember, what you remember fondly, what you remember from a place of fear, what's in there, and it gets in the way. And you can't hear from God because the sexual inventory and this invisible playground where the enemy just whispers, or where you talk. Well, I can't tell this part, but it's all up here. It's a memory that you hold. And if we're supposed to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, sometimes piece by piece, item by item, experience by experience, you need to lay it down. Lord, there's this. And there's that, and there's him, and there's her, and there's them, and this is what it is, God. And I want this off of me. It's not serving me well. I can't hear you good enough. It's affecting how I communicate with my spouse. I can't hear you well because all this stuff is in here. Now, I know we got a more mature crowd, and people think that this is just young people problems, but it's not. I only got 15 claps on that one, Pastor. I ain't gonna judge nobody. I ain't gonna ask you to raise your hand, but you know what you deal with. You know what you think of. You know what goes on in your mind and in your heart that sometimes becomes almost a barrier between you and your spouse because I just can't get past this. I could talk about that, but I won't talk about this. We can address this. I can pray about this, but this just is what it is. We give the enemy license in our life because we say things like, it just is what it is. Everything in my life, every experience in my life is subject to the power of God and what God wants to do. There is not one thing that I've been through, that I've done, that I've experienced, that cannot be covered by the blood of Jesus, by the mercy of God, and by the cross. Don't you ever minimize the cross because you feel like, oh, my sin is so bad. Not even Jesus on the cross can deal with it. The cross can cover and handle every single thing, everything you've been, everything you've done, what you struggle with, what you're depressed about, what has held you down, piece by piece, the Holy Spirit can bring revelation, can bring forgiveness, redemption, revive, restore, renew, and repair every situation in your life. But you first got to open the bag, unpack the bag, piece by piece.
Wow. Hallelujah. Then we got to deal with it.
Uh-huh.
Now that bag's unpacked.
Yeah. It's all out there.
She said, pull things out the bag piece by piece, but then sometimes life happens and the bag just dumps out all at once.
Yeah.
Either way, we got to deal with what's in the bag.
Yeah.
How do we talk about what's in the bag?
Yeah.
I don't want to talk about it
because
I'm embarrassed by it.
Right.
I don't want to talk about it because I'm ashamed of it. I never wanted you to know that about me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You married a man, dark-skinned, good-looking.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Indeed, I did.
But now, I'm afraid that you see me differently.
My.
You ain't gonna look at me the same.
Wow, that's good.
But the bag is open now.
Uh-huh.
And so now, there's some stuff in that bag that I got to be forgiven for.
Mm-hmm.
And I need you to forgive me because guess what? When I did it, I asked God to forgive me.
Yeah.
He did. But what I did, I sinned before God, but I did it to you.
Mm-hmm.
And God is not physically down here with us.
Come on.
He'll forgive me, but I won't physically feel it.
Yes.
Until you forgive me.
Wow.
So now, that's why I said you got to forgive people. You never know whose freedom you're holding in your mouth.
Yes.
Wow.
There's some stuff that has to be forgiven.
Yes.
In my bag.
Yes.
You got to deal with it. 2008, April 2008 on a Friday.
Mm-hmm.
I had so much stuff in my bag and it weighed me down so much. Not just sin, but stress. I was ambitious. I built a home in LA, had an apartment in New York, had 7 employees, a studio building, and just money, hemorrhaging money, 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 just stress, stress, stress. I go to the doctor because I'm not feeling quite my best. Doctor tells me I have cancer. Hallelujah. Cancer, on a Friday, I was diagnosed with renal cell carcinoma, kidney cancer. Cancer-free the next Friday. Oh, you can put a praise right there. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Can I go into the testimony a little further?
Glory to God. Glory to God.
I don't want to gross anybody out, but how they found that there was some blood somewhere. And so the doctor said, well, how much pain are you in? I said, well, I'm not in pain. His eyes got big as golf balls. He said, you know what? You need to go get a CAT scan now. I'm afraid something's wrong with your kidneys. I go to get a CAT scan, and there was a mass on my kidney the size of a grapefruit. Don't know how long it had been there. But I suspect it has something to do with the stuff that was in my bag. In an operation, they took the kidney out. declared me cancer-free, no radiation, just Jesus, no chemo, just Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Can I?
Now here's the kicker. Here's my shout here. Post-op meeting I have with my doctor. This doctor is a Muslim man. He don't know who I know.
Yes.
How I know it.
Yes.
And so he looked at me and he said, well, 20 years of doing this like this, I've never caught this like that. He said, the type of cancer you had, was a silent killer. He said, you could have just been walking around and dropped dead and we wouldn't know what's wrong with you till we opened you up and did an autopsy. Wow. He said, it's a good thing you bled. Wow. I said, it's a good thing I bled. He said, the blood saved your life. Well, I know I'm not the only one in here who can say the blood saved your life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Can I?
Hallelujah.
Can I jump in? Can I jump in? So on the day that he found out, here's where faith comes in. On the day that he found out and he called me, I was at a spa, I was paying for my services, and he told me what happened. When he told me what happened, I hit the ground. The lady at the counter said, are you all right? I said, no, but I will be. That was my faith responding. I don't know why I said that. So I walked down the street screaming to the top of my lungs. I said, God, this on Beverly Hills on La Cienega, right by the Beverly Center, which is a big, fabulous, famous mall. I said, Lord, this ain't what you said to me.
Yeah.
You didn't show me no dead husband. You ain't show me no dead husband. So Satan, the Lord, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. My husband shall live and not die. And every night during that week, I laid my hand on his body and I said, you are healed, whole, and complete in the mighty name of Jesus every single day. I didn't let nobody call me crying. I didn't let nobody call me with no death plans. I didn't let nobody call me saying, what you gonna do? Because I already knew what I was gonna do. I was gonna trust God. And every day I laid my hands on his body. And when he went in that surgery and came out, we asked the doctors before they went in, can we pray with you? And we anointed the doctor's hands because I believe that God created doctors. How you handle your stuff, how you go through your stuff is everything. Yeah. You can be in a dark tunnel and there can be a light at the end of the tunnel. But if you fight your whole way through, you're gonna bump your elbow, you're gonna bump your head,
yeah.
You may fall, but if you keep your eye on the light, if you keep your eye on Jesus and release some baggage, if you keep your eye on Jesus and you let go of some stuff, you'll get there. It may not be the day you want or the way you want, but you'll get there because God keeps his promises. If he says he's a healer, he'll do it. It may not be the way you want it, but he will heal and then he'll use it for his glory. Not your glory, but for his glory. And that's what we're supposed to live to do, to give God glory. My life can give him glory. My stuff can give him glory. My pain can give him glory, but only if you let him.
Hallelujah. So then the doctor asked me after I got through crying, he says, I really want to know. I said, Doc, I don't want to go through this again. At the time I was young, I was 32 years old. I said, how can something like this happen to me? I don't eat bad. At the time, we had hired a chef for that year. We were vegans. Our whole family were eating great, exercising every day. I was in great shape. Not like the shape I'm in now. I'm still in shape. Don't play me. I'm in shape. I'm round. I'm in round. Quit making me laugh. I'm trying to be serious. I said, Doc, I don't want to do this again. How can I prevent this? He says, well, let me ask you a couple questions. Is there something that's happened to you that you have not forgiven? Is there something that you've been holding on to? He said, do you have any secrets?
The doctor.
Do you have any stress? All that stuff was in my bag. And it was coming out in my body. What's in your bag this morning? I encourage you, don't find out and don't deal with the stuff in your bag like I did. Don't let sickness have to pull it out of you. I encourage everybody in here to voluntarily just start unpacking your bag. Because what happens is, God does not want you to have an empty bag. He just wants to pack the bag for you.
Yes. Yes.
And let me say it better than I just said it. He don't want to pack the bag for you. He wants to pack the bag with you.
Yes.
Because God doesn't do anything to you, for you, through you, without you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. Allow God to help us pack the bag, to put the things in that he wants.
Yes.
I'm glad to say now, that bag that I was carrying years ago was just old beat up brown paper bag. Now my bag is a nice Gucci pulley bag. full of peace.
Yes.
Full of joy.
Yes.
Full of love.
Yes.
Full of mercy.
Yes.
Full of kindness.
Yes.
Full of thanksgiving.
Yes.
That's my new bag.
Yes.
Full of a great wife.
Yes.
Great life. Lots of sex in this bag. Lots of sex in this.
There's children. It's Sunday morning. Okay.
I'm sorry. Bad pastor. But it's true.
Amen.
New bag. New results.
Yes. New bag, new life. New bag, new way of thinking. New bag, new way of existing. Sometimes it's a challenge to do things new. This is the way I've always done it. This is the way I've always been. But listen, I don't want to say I serve God and then live without God. I don't want to say I represent God, but I don't have nothing that reflects God. My personality, my actions, my life doesn't reflect what God says it should reflect. And they will know we are Christians by our love, not by our attitude, not by our fear. They will know we are Christians, believers, by our love, by how we operate and treat other people. Do people see you and see Jesus, or do they see your issues first?
Wow.
Even the continents on your face, do they want to run the other way because you don't look like joy or peace? Do they want to look the other way because he just looked mean? We should be a reflection of God's love. That's what he wants to pour on the inside. That's what he wants to equip us with. Love is powerful. Love transforms. It repairs and it moves things. It shifts things. It reveals who you are to you. It gives you the power to say, forgive me. It gives you the power to say, I forgive you.
Yeah.
And to mean it. And then to watch what God does through a life surrendered or a bag surrendered. You know, the young kids always talk about, I got to secure the bag.
Secure the bag.
Secure, they do this hand. I got to secure that bag. And it's all about money. But if you have money and you don't have joy or peace, it's like you're reaching for something, but you can never hold it because you think that means security. You think it means power. You think it means acceptance and value, but you're trying to secure something that won't give you what you're looking for. Nothing but Jesus. Nothing but the power of the Holy Spirit will give you the sense of security that you're looking for. So even if you don't have physically in life the things that you think you need, because you and I know it sounds like, yeah, I got Jesus, I got more than enough. Because you don't believe it, you don't receive the power that comes from it. Yesterday I said all things are possible to them that believe. If you don't believe that God will really stand by his word, you're not going to experience it because it's too much doubt and anxiety and skepticism and cynicism and sarcasm and all those things. Oh, God really gone. Oh, I just got to be realistic. I don't want to be realistic. I want to operate in the supernatural. I want my life to reflect the grace and mercy of God that makes people go, how did she? Now, I know they went through this. They was on Black Love. They was on TV. They told her, well, how do they smiling like that?
How in the world does she still like him when they went through this and went through that? It's because God is right here. It's me, it's God in the middle, and it's him. And that's the most important thing. Is God in your bag? Is God the most important thing? Is that where you get your information? Are you getting it from television? Are you getting it from Facebook? Or are you getting it from the Word of God? We love singing Fred Hammond's song, God will do what he said he'll do. He'll stand by his word. We don't know his word, so we don't know what he'll do. If we don't get in the book, if we don't understand what he's saying to us about us, why are there so many examples of so many lives and so many ups and downs? You going through because that's just life. Sometimes we just got to be a little tougher a little bit. We can't be spiritual wimps. We don't want to go through nothing. Don't hurt my feelings. Don't talk. They going to talk about you. So?
So what?
You may gain and lose. So? If he going to supply my needs according to his riches and glory, I don't have to worry about that stuff. No way. The only thing I have to hold tightly to is God. He really didn't, I love y'all, but he didn't tell me to trust people. He told me to trust him. So even if I'm in a room full of devils, I'm still covered by the blood of Jesus. Because that's in my bag. Me and my Holy Ghost bag came in a room. Devils all around. What you doing? Me and Jesus right here? I got too much Holy Ghost to be scared of you. I got too much Holy Ghost to be worried about who's going to try to sabotage me. The Holy Ghost going to stop you and elevate me because I'm listening to him. He gonna cancel you and promote me because I'm listening to him. Because he's in my bag. That's my confidant. That's my counselor. That's my go-to. That's where I find my information. I ain't scrolling to find out. I'm picking up the book. Ain't nothing wrong with looking at your Bible on the phone either, but that physical Bible is just something different about it, ain't it? It's the word. It's the word. It's the word of God. It's the word of God that equips you and prepares you and gives you everything that you need. So when you look at your spouse and you know what you've been through, I see him, but I see Jesus. And I'm not making him Jesus. I see the God on the inside that's going to use him and me together. But if I see him as the enemy, we can't do what God called. I can't parent right if all I say is my kids get on my nerves. I can't love my church right if I'm busy having conversations with us for the first ladies talking about how horrible the church is. The church is not horrible. We have to change what we say. And this is just an extra one. I'm going to throw this in. When you say foolishness, I think hell gets happy. When you constantly negative, I think hell gets happy. Good, 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 good. I think the devil is literally going, good, good, good. Keep letting them see the foolish stuff. So they have no faith. So they have no hope. So they don't even speak life for their own church. They trying to get all that stuff for. What Pastor Matthew trying to get all that? That's too much. He trying to do too much. No. Don't you hinder the blessings of God with your negative talking.
Hallelujah.
You can secure everything that God has for you, but God has to be. You got to speak God's language, and God's language is his word. Yeah. Said he'll honor his word above his name. So you can rock around going, G, 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 oh, G, 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 G. Or you can say, God, you said you're going to supply my needs according to your riches and glory. I'm going to lay out all these bills, and Lord, you're going to tell me, show me strategically how to handle my finances, who I should align with, when I cut the credit card off, you're going to show me what to do. I'm not going to keep buying and just go, G, 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 because he ain't going to do nothing for you without you. You can't come home slinging blessed oil all over your house and go, you got to talk to your husband and actually be nice. You actually have to pray over your kids. Your kids have to hear you praying out loud. And then sometimes you tell them to pray. So you build up their ability to pray and speak life in your house. You shouldn't be the only one praying in your house. If you got children, you should be raising little prayer warriors. Sometimes when my kids are naughty, I'll tell them, leave that. You rebuke the devil. Say, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. Five. Satan, the Lord rebuke you. That's right. Jesus lives inside. Jesus living inside. Train up a child in the way. I'm going off. Sorry, husband. Train up a child in the way he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart. Especially if he's equipped or she's equipped with the word of God.
Amen. 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 Can we all stand to our feet?
Bag check. Bag check.
If you received the word this morning, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the revelation of your word, Father. We know this is great ground, Father. We only ask that the seed of this word take root and grow into fruit. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Everybody say, thank God.
Thank God.
Come on like you mean it. Thank God.
Thank God.
Amen. God bless you. God bless you.
Come on, help me thank God for the word today. Come on, help me thank God for the word that became alive, that became incarnated. And now we want to make room for the fruit of the word. As we continue to stand, we want to extend to you the ultimate relationship, the relationship that matters and makes a difference in every other relationship. I want to know, do you have a relationship with God that only comes through Jesus? I said, do you have a relationship with God that only comes through his son, Jesus? Are you saved? Have you allowed Jesus to become Lord of your life? Have you accepted him in your heart? If you're here, you're unsaved, unsure about what it means to be saved. If you've never been born again, then today is going to be your next birthday. You've been born already in the flesh. Now it's time for you to be born again from above in the spirit. And so if you're here and you need to be saved, we want you to give your life to Christ right now. It starts here at the altar. The second invitation is for somebody who is already saved. You're a Christian, but you don't have an altar that is home. You don't have a church home. Y'all hear what I just said? You are spiritually homeless. You don't have a corporate altar that you can come to. You don't have a place where you sit under the word, where you're growing in the spirit, where you're using your gifts to build up the body of Christ. If you don't have a church home where you're growing, then I invite you right now to make a faith decision, a destiny decision that will change the rest of your life. Put your hands together. The door of the church is open right now. Come and be saved. Come and join the church. Come watch God do a new thing in your life. You know you're here. So don't wait. Don't worry. Don't wrestle. Step out by faith. Walk forward right now. Watch God do a new thing in your life. Hallelujah. Come on, my brother. Come on, my sister. Don't blend in when God is calling you forward. So God wants you saved. God wants you in a church where you're growing. That's God's plan for your life. I don't know your name, where you're from, your background, or your baggage, but I know this. He wants you to have a saving relationship. He wants you to have a church home where you're growing. Shouldn't you want what God wants for you? You want to be blessed? Well, you have to go and follow the plan of blessing. I want you to help God open the door. There's somebody here that needs to make a faith decision, and it's kind of intimidating, all these folks up in here. So we want to make it a little easier. We want to let you know that we're not here to judge or to look down on you. We're here to celebrate what God is doing in your life, because we had to take the same walk one day ourselves. So can y'all help me open the door? Can y'all help me open the door? Everybody, I want you to go find somebody. Y'all know what to do, right? Y'all know what to do. Go find you somebody and make sure it's right with them and they're in the right place. Come on, all over the house. We're waiting for you. God's waiting for you. You make all things.
You make all things.
Come on, my brother. Come on, my sister. God bless you. Now, we got one. You don't have to be the first one. You can be the next one. Come out and come out wherever you are, whoever you are, and however you are. You can come like you are, but you won't remain like you are. Hallelujah. Come on. We got two. Come on. There's somebody else. We're waiting. God's waiting. The Bible says, the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. That means the day I call you, that's the day I want you to come forward. Come on. Sing that one more time. We're waiting. Come on, my brother. Don't miss this. Come on, my sister. That's a beautiful thing. Amen. You want to praise God. Reverend, who do we have?
We have Darlene McKay coming to join Kingdom Fellowship. And we have Brother Patros coming to join Kingdom Fellowship.
Yeah.
McCall. I'm sorry. Darlene McCall coming to join Kingdom Fellowship.
Amen. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Amen. See this brother, this sister come forward. And he came first. I love it. I love it. I can't get enough of it. Come on, isn't that how it's supposed to be? I said, isn't that how it's supposed to be? We're praising God for your faith decision today. Amen. We're praising God for you following the Spirit of God and moving forward by faith. I'm going to ask y'all to go out with Sister Lisa. We're going to pray with y'all in the back and cover y'all in the back. Come on, put your hands together. Let's celebrate with them. Somebody shout, welcome home.
Welcome home
to the family of faith. Now listen, they're heading to a room called Matthew, and maybe you are one of my holdouts. You know good and well you're supposed to come down this aisle, but you felt a little funny about walking down in front of the crowd, and so I got a hookup for you. Amen. I got a hookup for you. If you just want to go to Matthew, as soon as I pronounce the benediction, we'll take you any way we can get you. We just want you to leave, amen, unsaved, without a church home where you're going. Weren't you blessed by the Campbells today? Amen. Weren't you blessed by the Campbells today? Amen. And we're so grateful to God. They're going to be with us at 10 and at 12 as well. In addition, Sister Erica brought her latest book, and you can go and pick that up and be blessed of God. And we're going to have an awesome time. Receive now the benediction, grace, peace, and mercy from God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Rest will abide now with these your people, both now and forevermore. People, God said amen. Come on, say it again. Say it one more time. God bless you. See you Tuesday night for Bible study. Kingdom.